Morning. My name is David Scott. I'm the Vice Chairman of the Council on Tall Buildings and Urban Habitat, and I'm here to welcome you to day two of our conference. Today our focus is on what is happening in India, what is happening particularly in Mumbai, and how Mumbai and India are trying to redevelop itself to become a vibrant Indian, to develop vibrant Indian renewable cities. So it's from an outsider's perspective, it is going to be one of the most interesting days of the conference. And of course, this afternoon, then we're taking tours out to actually see Indian Mumbai under construction and the buildings that have been built there. So I'd like to welcome this morning's speakers up onto the stage. Professor Sandy Kim will be chairing the first session. So please put your hands together and welcome the speakers of the first session.
Good morning. My name is Sandy Kim. I'm the chair of this morning's plenary session two for remaking Mumbai. The first speaker is Mr. Gaiwat, Metropolitan Commissioner of Mumbai Metropolitan Redevelopment Agency. I'd like to welcome the next speakers. First, Lalit Gandhi and Mayank Gandhi. Their title is an Integrated Development Plan for Mumbai. The first speaker will be Lalit Gandhi. Would you please welcome him?
Honorable Chairman of the session and all delegates, friends. On this great event, when over 1,000 delegates from across the world, including 72 speakers, experts and wizards in the field of urban planning and designing, are assembled here for deliberating on the subject how to remake sustainable cities focusing on vertical expansions. Mumbai is today standing on a volcano where 50 to 60% of its over 60 to 75,000 acres of its area is occupied by slums and dilapidated buildings. I have narrated yesterday Mumbai's remaking and urban renewal is concentrated on one hand removal of slums while on other systematic demolition of these over 32,000 old and dilapidated buildings which have outlived their lives. Both this process can only become result-oriented if the same is carried out in a planned manner, and hence, if the city of Mumbai is to remake an integrated development plan of Mumbai is to be prepared in advance, which is the topic of discussion for this session. While doing this process of integrated planning, most important two factors to be highly considered are planning of infrastructure and second, creating of sustainability and eco-friendliness, which we may say has almost vanished today. A mammoth task to plan the city of Mumbai in an integrated manner to remake it. Task is difficult, but again I say not impossible, if performed systematically. At the time of formation of remaking of Mumbai Federation, ROMF in the end of 2005, ROMF has put up a concept composite solution to government, leading to a holistic integrated planning of Mumbai city and its practical and successful implementation. The experience in last 3 to 4 decades shows that all respective departments in the government and in civic body of Mumbai as regards planning and execution of city developments are not moving in tandem with expertise, and hence all related activities have progressed in isolated manner and the growth have occurred in unplanned, incremental and haphazard manner, led to a disastrous situation. You are experiencing all this while coming over here in city of Mumbai. Mr. Gaikwad has put up an absolutely ambitious plan. But whether all related departments have planned the same thing in a tandem or not, that is to be seen. Remaking of Mumbai Federation is planning to have integrated planning under one platform, as I have narrated yesterday. The concept of solution as suggested by ROMF evolves the sectorial planning of the whole city by a city planning and monitoring company, CPMC, a body is to be formed. CPMC formed and working under corporate governance on PPP, public-private partnership basis. Here is a new concept. In case of execution, yes, PPP are under implementation. But whether planning, integrated planning, can such body be formed? Public-private partnership basis. Such company will hold 50% representations from experts, global and national, while other 50% from all respective government, department, public sector, undertaking, civic bodies, who all are concerned with the respective urban planning and infrastructural departments. The whole city area may be divided into hundreds of sectors, each of around about 50 to 60 sector acres, and a detailed sectorial urban and infrastructural planning should be done in a continuity, and then sector by sector development, SSDS, should be done. The whole essence of ROMF suggestion is CPMC, City Planning and Monitoring Company, for planning and integrated planning of the whole city of Mumbai, and then SSDS, sector by sector development of the same. The mission we are to share with all of you and inviting you to join is a formation of the CPMC. The balance 50% part of the CPMC shall be constituted from all of you, and an appropriate socio-economic structure will be formed which will use this treasure of knowledge from all of you in a very channelized manner to carry out the integrated planning of city of Mumbai in coordination with balanced 50% of the respective authorities. The scope of such body can be extended to all metros and big cities of India and the whole world, which are yet waiting to be transformed into a world-class cities, embodied with sustainability and eco-friendliness atmosphere. We are mainly focusing remaking of Mumbai Federation out of the two parts, that is slum as well as dilapidated buildings. We are focusing on dilapidated building, which we call as the inner city. In Mumbai, 16,500 acres of the South Mumbai are comprised of over 32,000 dilapidated buildings. And we call this as an inner city because subsequently in all the big cities of the world, before a century, these buildings are developed and today they have outlived their lives and are to be demolished. And a new city is to be formed into that. A typical presentation of South Mumbai, how it could be transformed into a world-class city, is made and will be shown by our Federation Secretary Mayank Gandhi. Thank you all.
Good morning. You all have experienced the problems of Mumbai. Overheated city, too many people coming in. Lot of solutions, but I think the problems are running faster than the solutions. Which is why I think you must be seeing all of these things every day. Some of you have come from outside. I think when you go for the technical tour, you realize the extent of the issues. Open space in the world, the 8th filthiest city in the world. There's a lot that needs to be done. So there are three critical issues. One is housing, the second is infrastructure, and third is the governance. These are the major issues which need to be resolved if you are going to make Mumbai into a livable city. There is a shortage of housing. There are 50,000 families who are living on the pavements. And because this is a magnet of economic magnet, in a country where there is so much poverty, in a landscape where there is so much deprivation, you see all these people coming to Mumbai. And in a country like ours, you cannot stop people. I don't think that's the right solution. So you need to provide for them. MMRDA is looking at certain rental housing projects to take care of that. Slums, as you all are aware, 55% of Mumbai is made up of slums. The Slum Redevelopment Authority is looking into that. So the point I'm trying to make is that while there are problems, there are solutions being looked at. So these are some of the major infrastructure projects. Our earlier speaker spoke a lot about them. But this is a festering wound in the heart of the city which no one has looked at. It is the inner city. There are 500,000 families, 2.5 million people living in over 30,000 buildings. These are buildings which have been made pre-1940 by the British. They're in very precarious conditions. The infrastructure there is very poor. And because of certain archaic laws, the Rent Control Act, for example, these were never redeveloped because there were no incentive for the landlords to redevelop. There were no incentive for the landlord to actually repair it. And which is why the dilapidation is getting into worse condition. Some of the pictures of the infrastructure, the building conditions. This is a typical average living space of people who are workers there. 8 people live in this room and they sleep in shifts. After 8 hours, you would have another group coming and sleeping. And there have been 2,750 minor and major collapses of this building. 750 people have died. In Israel, if 5 people die, they go to war. When 10 Americans died in the 26/11, America changes entire policy. Here we have 750 people who have been dying, and it's accelerating the deaths. So something needs to be done. After the 26 July 2005 heavy rains, where four buildings fell one after the other and about 100 people died, this remaking of Mumbai was formed to work closely with the government to find some solutions. And after that, 500 buildings have been declared as dangerous. People have been shifted. They're going to transit accommodations, which are in some places worse than hell. I know of a case where a transit accommodation was close to collapse and they had to take them to a transit of a transit. So the government in the last year or so has come out with some very good policies. There have been two models. The first model is redevelopment of individual buildings. So old buildings have been given certain incentives on a public-private partnership so that developers can develop that. And due to that, a lot of old buildings have been redeveloped into single towers. Now, these are the individual building development. Now, this, there is a tremendous load on the infrastructure. So going vertical, increasing the density, increasing the number of people is loading the infrastructure, reducing open space parking, shortage of water. Average travel speed is now reduced. Damage to the cultural heritage, because all you are doing is these glass tall towers, which can as well be placed in Shanghai or in Hong Kong, being picked up and put in India with no context, with no knowledge of the condition. And these are all unsustainable models of development. So quality of life, I believe that this solution is probably worse than the problem. It would have been better if we had maintained the problem rather than do this kind of individual redevelopment. A case in point is a place near Nana Chowk, where 50 towers are coming up, another 150 have been approved, without a single square inch of road being increased, water lines being changed, the drainage being upgraded. It's going to be an unmitigated disaster. So remaking of Mumbai has been working closely with the government to change the model of redevelopment. The government has been very forthright, and they have, the 2007 housing policy has taken care of this redevelopment on a cluster basis. And it says that MADA, along with tenants, landlords, private developers, come together on a PPP basis for redeveloping on a cluster basis. What it really means is that you take about 100, 200, 500 buildings together, redevelop that entire neighborhood or precinct or cluster, and then augment and increase the infrastructure. Now this, for example, is one of the models that we are working on. What it would do is it would upgrade and augment the infrastructure. The tenants, the developers would be given a certain amount of corpus fund, the interest of which will take care of the lifetime maintenance for the existing people there. These people will be rehoused in a temporary accommodation, given guarantees that they will be back in a certain time frame, and when the new buildings are built, they will be brought back there. It's an inclusive approach because we are trying to bring the community together, bring them into this entire process. Restore the heritage and the religious building which are there. Not just restore them, augment it. For example, in the area that we are working, there is a Mumba Devi temple by which the name of Mumbai is there. There's no way that you can get into that with a vehicle. So we intend to have a water body opposite that and see that people can come there and spend a day there. The Jama Masjid does not have a place to pray, so we want to increase that. Financial incentives to the building landlords, holistic planning, sustainable development, and the fast process of, if you want to remake the city, you cannot do it in building by building. You'll have to do it cluster by cluster. And this is a self-financing model. The finance comes from the land leveraging of this process. And it's a win-win solution for all sections. In a noisy, vibrant, fantastic democracy like India, you cannot do anything unless you bring everyone together. All stakeholders need to be together. So the quality of life is going to increase because of this. Now this is Mumbai. We have mapped all the buildings of Mumbai. This is the inner city where over 50% or more are these old buildings. Now this is some of the towers. See, this is built, and these are the suburban rail. If you divide this into sectors with arterial and subarterial roads, according to us, you would get about 100 clusters of 70 acres. Now, if you were to do smaller ones, 30, some bigger, then you may end up with about 150 to 200 clusters. Now, this, so 16,500 acres of the island city where these buildings are, we need to make these 70 clusters of 100 clusters of 70, where majority of the buildings are old and dilapidated, surrounded by arterial, subarterial road. The trunk infrastructure needs to be maintained and restoration of religious. But what really the call that I make to the decision makers here is, unless you stop the individual redevelopment, this is never going to happen. Because in a cluster, once you start having all these tall towers which are going to come up, then there is no hope for cluster redevelopment. Already a lot of permissions have been given for individual buildings, but the government has to take some strong decisions. And there are places beyond these clusters where individual buildings can be developed. But within these clusters, you need to stop redevelopment on an individual basis. Else, once these new buildings are made, for the next 100 years, you're not going to be able to do anything. And while we are redeveloping, we need to build the sustainable processes of economic, ecological, and social components. And what would be the outcome to that? Because it's a self-financing scheme, a part of the profits that are made after cross-subsidization by the developers will go into a dedicated infrastructure. So you would get about 50,000 crores or 5,000 million rupees, which will become a dedicated infrastructure fund for this. So the government is not paying, but it gets a lot of wealth to take care of the infrastructure of the city of Mumbai. Affordable housing for the people who are living will get a better quality of house. Over 10,000 free units will be made for the economic weaker section and the lower income group. Good quality housing for the rehabilitated people and world standard life quality. In specifics, water today is present less than 100 liters. Once you go for individual development, it will go to 80. But with cluster, it will go about 135. Sewage, the quality will improve. Parking will improve because the new buildings and the cluster will have a lot of parking. The 0.03 acres would increase to 0.6, 20 times more increase in open space. Because once you densify and you go vertical, you leave about 70% open space in the project that we are doing, which will increase it. Right now, the open space in the 233 acres that we are looking at is 11%. And with this, it goes to 70%. So assuming that that's not true of all the sections, but we would still get 20 times more open space and the quality of life will improve. The tree ratio will improve, human to tree. School dispensaries, new infrastructure, amenities can be put up. Road network will increase substantially and the waste disposal will become an excellent quality. So you have these win-win solutions. So you could parallelly develop. You don't need to develop one after the other. These 100 clusters can be developed parallelly. And while you are doing that, you could phase it up. And the phase one would be the rehab component. And then the free sale residential, the people shifted would be back. This would be free sale, sorry. And this would be the new schools, dispensaries, hospitals, green spaces. This would be the commercial rehab. Free sale commercial. So if you were to do that 100 times more, This is the 233 acre that we are developing. The first one model that we showed was of 30 acres. We are showing you different models by which redevelopment can take place. But it needs to be said that while you are doing one of the clusters, you will need to parallelly start doing a lot of them, or the end of an infrastructure cannot be connected. So the entire city needs to be planned in a holistic manner, and then these clusters, these sectors need to be developed as fast as possible. This is the 233 acre that we intend to develop. Now, coming to the last point, which is the governance issue. We have a multiplicity of authorities in Mumbai. If you travel on the Western Express Highway, that road is owned by PWD. As you climb the bridge, it becomes MSRDC. When you turn right, it becomes the BMC road. As you go a little further, it becomes the central government railways. So what really is needed is to get all these parastatal government bodies into one government undertaking in which you have a central, state and local governments, and various stakeholders, tenants, landlords, architects, engineers, citizen groups should come into another part of it, and jointly they should form something which we call the City Planning and Monitoring Company, which would be a single window, single place, redevelopment, which would give an impetus, which would definitely not have the regulatory aspects, but it will have a very suggestive aspects, which would do the survey, planning, manage the finances, look after the environment, have an advisory committee for transparency and accountability, and then monitor the projects. Monitor the cluster development that happens in terms of time, quality, and aesthetic parameters. So before I end, I would just like to make a few other points. To make a city, and I get nightmares, I wake up sometimes, this country has been ravaged hundreds of times. We have had all kind of people coming into this country, and the soul of this country is, I'm not too sure if it is completely destroyed or not. And we had a knowledge system which is completely gone. We had something called the Stapatya Veda, a book of knowledge on urban planning. We had the Mohenjo-daro, the Harappa, which used to have those grids, drainages. We had some fantastic knowledge. All of that is lost. And very importantly, we have a decision-making process which is taken by a few people at the top. There is almost no consultative process with the people whose lives is affected by this kind of master planning, this kind of urban planning. So what you really need is institutionalizing of this decentralized decision making. Unless you do that, we'll all be planning in vacuum. We'll be doing things which has got no relevance to the people. I was talking, people said, what does that panwala, what does that shopkeeper know about how a city is to be planned? And trust me, I've been working enough with the community to tell you probably he knows far more about where the road should be, what should its size, what should be the parking. Unless a consultative approach, unless a democratic, grassroots, decentralized approach is taken, we will all the time get it wrong. And let me say something which I said yesterday, even though it will take two more minutes, sir. When Mahatma Gandhi came to India from South Africa, and he wanted to fight the freedom war, if he had engaged some foreign international consultants, we would have got bloodshed, war, violence, guerrilla warfare, attacking from here, there. But he went back to the country. He traveled for 3 years. He understood the ethos of this country. He understood the soul of this country. And he brought forward tools like truth, non-violence, renunciation. He brought in the best world standards of communication. He had great people from all over the world who came and supported him. So we need to look for the soul of India before we plan anything, or we are going to make some real big mistakes. I can see that as I read the headlines, as I look at things, that we are making some major mistakes. We have been ravaged 100 of time. I think we may be ravaged one more time. So my suggestion is that we take the best global practices, married with the Indian knowledge system and with a democratic decision making, create a unique city, a unique world-class Mumbai. And I always go back to Margaret Mead, who said, do not doubt that a small group of thoughtful people can change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that ever has. Thank you so much.